I'm Robert Bruce Thompson, and this is the Home Scientist video series. In this segment, we'll isolate elemental bromine from a water treatment chemical sold by swimming pool and hot tub suppliers. The chemical is called bromine base, which is actually crude sodium bromide. It's available in 1 or 2 pound bottles for $4 or $5 a pound. Like the other halogens, bromine is very corrosive and produces irritating and choking fumes. Although it's liquid at room temperature, its low boiling point and high vapor pressure mean it readily produces toxic and corrosive vapors. If you use the procedure described in this video to isolate bromine, do it only outdoors or under an exhaust hood. I'll use the same reaction to isolate bromine that I used in an earlier video to isolate iodine. Acidifying a solution that contains bromide ions and reacting the solution with a strong oxidizer oxidizes bromide ions to elemental bromine. Or at least it's supposed to. Okay, let's get started. The molar mass of sodium bromide is 102.894 grams per mole. I've weighed out 5.15 grams of sodium bromide, which is about 0.05 moles. Sodium bromide is 77.66% bromine by mass, so our expected yield of bromine is 4.0 grams. Sodium bromide is extremely soluble in water, so I actually need only about 6 or 7 milliliters to dissolve my sample. I'm going to add more than that because, as we'll see, excess water isn't a problem. With the sodium bromide dissolved, the next step is to add a strong mineral acid. I'm using hydrochloric acid, but you can also use sulfuric acid or any other strong mineral acid. The next step is to oxidize the bromide ions to elemental bromine. You can use almost any strong oxidizer to do that, including chlorine laundry bleach or potassium permanganate. I'm using ordinary drugstore 3% hydrogen peroxide because it's a very strong oxidizer that reacts to form only oxygen and water. I need at least 0.05 moles of hydrogen peroxide to oxidize all of the bromide ions to elemental bromine. Drugstore peroxide solution is about 0.8 molar, or about 0.0008 moles per milliliter, so I need about 62.5 milliliters. I'm actually using about 75 milliliters to make sure the peroxide is in excess. For the first few seconds, nothing appears to happen. As the reaction proceeds, the solution assumes a gradually deeper yellow color as the bromide ions are oxidized to elemental bromine. So we'll allow this to sit for the reaction to continue to completion. Okay, it's been a couple hours and the results aren't what I expected. The solution in the flask is now a fairly intense yellow-orange color, which indicates that there's some bromine present, but not nearly as much as I expected. Frankly, when I added the hydrogen peroxide, I expected results similar to what occurred when I added the hydrogen peroxide to the iodide mixture in the earlier video. That is, for the relatively instantaneous transformation of the bromide ion to liquid bromine. Clearly, that's not occurred. We do have some bromine in the flask, which is what's giving it the orange color, but nowhere near as much as I expected. Well, as it turned out, I didn't end up with the concentrated bromine water I was expecting. Instead, I ended up with about 100 milliliters of relatively dilute bromine water. That worked for what I needed it for in the first place, testing some organics for unsaturation. But what happened here raises an important point. As any practicing chemist will tell you, things don't always work out the way you expect them to, even if you've done the same reaction successfully before. Sometimes nothing at all happens. Sometimes a lot more happens than what you were expecting, which is why we always wear gloves and goggles in the lab. Please subscribe, rate, and comment.